All right, what's going on, guys? Welcome back to the Daru Strong Podcast. My name is Phil Daru. I'm your host. Today, we have a good one. Episode number 007 with Mark Smelly Bell. Now, Mark is an accomplished lifter, power lifter, business owner, also has his own podcast and YouTube channel that's very successful. We go over many different things. The one thing about Mark, and I've been on his podcast twice already, the one thing that he is very generous with his time and also with the things that he does for the industry. All right, so before we go ahead and talk to Mark, we had a lot of interesting conversation. I want to go ahead and hit up the sponsors. Make sure you check out RevivemD, RevivSups.com. Revive is a top of the line supplement company that I personally recommend to all of my athletes because the quality of the minerals, nutrition, and the testing that they do for the ingredients. You guys know how anal I am about, you know, methodology and also the concepts behind health and performance, which is why I personally take my athlete stack that I created with Revive. So again, I want you guys to make sure that you go and get that. If you guys click the link below, use DaruStrong20, all right, at the discount link to get 20% off of the entire store, including my personal athlete stack, which is available again at RevivSups.com. Also, if you want to get my MMA off-camp training program completely for free, this is a six-week MMA program that is for anyone who needs off-camp training or strength and conditioning. The program is completely free, and you can find it down below in the description. No credit cards or anything like that. And don't forget to subscribe to the YouTube channel for the Daru Strong Podcast. So you'll get that free program. Go ahead and subscribe to the Daru Strong Podcast. And let me know if you have any questions. And I also want to make sure that you guys know that I still have the MMA bodyweight only program. It's not only for MMA, but combat sports in general and just general public can get a lot out of it. It's a 8-week bodyweight only program, Body Armor, which is now 50% off for the entire time of this pandemic because I do want to help you guys out. I know that you're not able to get to the gym or train at all, so at least I'll give you this program so that you can at least maintain your gains, if not get better from a strength endurance standpoint and a mobility and conditioning standpoint. So without further ado though, here's Mark Bell, episode number 007. Let's get it.
Mind somewhere else and keep going. That little voice in your head is trying to stop you from getting to where you want to be. Be successful and keep moving forward.
With your host and world-renowned strength and conditioning coach, Phil Daru.
When things go wrong or there's hurdles, there's two types of people. There's either the ones that are going to triumph and jump over that fucking thing, or they're going to stop, halt, and just ultimately get worse. So at the end of the day, I'm that type of person, you're that type of person, and we just kind of keep, you know, hurtling over those road marks and we keep moving forward.
I would encourage people to, you know, check out some of the work of Ryan Holiday. Mm-hmm. I'm sure many of your listeners are familiar with him. He talks a lot about Stoic philosophy. Mm-hmm. He has a book called The Obstacle is the Way. And I think that, you know, this is a great time to practice some Stoicism. You know, these are a lot of theories that have been brought about by you know, famous emperors and things like that of Roman Empire, Marcus Aurelius being the most famous. And he had a book that he wrote to himself. So kind of, again, going back to this idea of like interviewing yourself. Well, when they went back and they looked at this book, they were like, wow, this is amazing. He wanted to like burn it before he died and stuff like that, but they wouldn't let him. They were like, no, man, people need to see this. Yeah. This is some really outstanding stuff. But really, the reason why the book is written, like the reason why his notes and it's called Meditation, the reason why it's written so well is because it's written to himself, and it's because he was super lonely. Like, yeah. Because he was the ruler of the world. He could do anything. He could have whatever woman he wants. Mm-hmm. He could do anything from a financial standpoint that you could possibly think of or dream of. I mean, he had like slaves and whatever else. Like he could access anything he wanted. He was the ruler of one of the greatest empires of all time. Mm-hmm. And he chose to utilize that time to make himself better. Gotcha. And he chose to recognize the fact that the only thing that we have rule over is our thoughts. And so I think that this is a great time to practice that. You know, you can check out Daily Stoic. You can check it out on YouTube. There's a lot of great information. But this is a really awesome time to get into some of these practices of just trying to think about, okay, well, that's not so great, but then there's this. Okay, that's not so great, but then there's that. Okay, I went to the grocery store not too long ago, and it's a place that I frequent. And they said, oh, you know, how are you doing? How's everything going with the quarantine and stuff? I said, you know what? I said, it's amazing. I get to spend so much time with my kids. Yep. And she just was like blown back by that. She goes, you are the first. She's like, everyone's been complaining about their kids. And I said, hey, you know what? Kids are a pain in the ass. We all are in full agreement of that. But I said, this is wonderful, because if my kids were younger, I would have a different perspective. My son is 16 and my daughter's 12. Mm-hmm. It's not like they're 8 and 4. That's when you pull your hair out and go crazy. but anyway, yeah, it's up to you to think about, you know, how are you going to interpret everything that's going on? And it's something I've been really studying a lot lately, is reinterpretation of how I think about things. Even think about death. Like, how bad is death? I don't know. Like, death is, let's, you know, use an example. Like, my oldest brother, he died. He was bipolar. He had a lot of addictions, right? So if we're able to pull back a few layers, if we're able to kind of like zoom out a few layers, and we're able to look at facts, then it's a lot easier to have a conversation with somebody about it. If I'm talking to you and you had a drug addiction, and I can say, Phil, man, I got something to share with you. You know, my oldest brother, he was bipolar. He didn't know how to deal with it. He had a tough time coping with the ups and downs of life. His highs and lows were higher and lower than most people. Mm-hmm. And he didn't really know that until he was older, and he got addicted to drugs. He was trying to self-medicate, stuff like that. You know what, Phil, I think it'd be good for you to, you know, go and see a doctor, go see a professional, because maybe there's some underlying reason why you're attracted to these drugs. Maybe there's something else going on that you're not aware of that makes this a whole different thing to tackle than what you thought. It's different than you just being like, oh, I'm done. I'm not going to do that shit anymore, right? Yeah. And so, but if you think about it from a factual perspective, my brother died. He was 38 years old. Wow. That's a very common age. It's a mid-30s thing. Wow. It's not, you know, everyone who's bipolar doesn't die at that same age, but it's an age where you start to have a lot of realization. You're like, wow, I'm over 35. My friends are married. My friends have kids. My friends have this. My friends have that. Why don't I have those things? Mm-hmm. It makes you feel very lonely. It makes you feel very depressed. And then, you know, the issue with the drugs was just, it was cyclical. You know, he would try to come off them the best that he could. But again, if we're to look at the facts, it's like, how many people are addicted to drugs? A lot of people are addicted to drugs. How many people suffer from bipolar disorder? Millions of people suffer from bipolar disorder. And in fact, it has never really been something that they could eradicate. They don't have like anything to really, when it comes to mental health in this country, it's a very tough thing to solve. It's a very tough thing to help. Some people get better and some people don't. And they don't seem to really 100% know. They know a lot, but they don't know 100% on what to do. And so when you start to think about it in those terms, it's a lot easier to deal with. Even somebody who got abused as a kid or something like that, you could say, well, you know, man, that is awful. Like, I cannot think of a word. There's like not that many things that are as bad as child abuse, right? Like child abuse, rape. I think we can agree, like, man, those are, man, absolutely horrific things, right? Mm-hmm. However, those things happen. They happen to a lot of people. And who knows why that person did that to you? I don't know. I don't have the information on why they did it. You'll probably actually never learn why they did that to you.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, right? And you start to kind of boil down the facts and you say, okay, well, I have to deal with this. Now I have a wife and kids myself. I need to figure out, how am I going to pull my shit together and be a good outstanding citizen, be a good father, be a good role model, be a good functioning part of society? Because what are your other options?
Yeah, and you know what? When you are in charge of your household at that point, there is more of a higher purpose. You have to put yourself, you know, last in a way. And that's one thing that with kids and a wife, like, I have to make sure that all of my shit is, like, pushed aside in a way, because they can't afford for me to be down in the dumps, you know? Now, do you think, like, with the bipolar disorder, do you think that's more environmental, or is that something biological, or do you think it's just like kind of a merge of both, like experiences and things like that?
Yeah, I definitely think, you know, you bringing it up in that way, I think it definitely is things probably merging together, you know, and then kind of almost like me. Like, I had a friend tell me this recently. He said that talking about like people that are psychotic, right? People that are like psychopaths, or even people that are like sociopaths and stuff like that. If we were to compare Phil DeRue and we were to compare Mark Bell to a serial killer, right? As wild as it sounds, they wouldn't have that many more boxes checked off in terms of their behavior than we would, right?
Yeah.
Like we have some impulses, we have some things we're not proud of, we have some anger, we have some energy in us, like maybe more when we were younger, right? Mm-hmm. But we kind of have like somebody does us wrong, you kind of want to punch him in the face, right? Like, mm-hmm. But at the same time, like, we know to shut that off, right? We know that that's not a great way to do it. We know choking somebody out randomly is not because they cut you off or because they said something dumb. You know, we learn that it's just not a good road to go down. We can think about it logically, right? Mm-hmm. But for my brother, you know, he had a really hard time thinking about things logically. And when we found out that he was bipolar, it made everything else make so much more sense. Mm-hmm. Then, you know, for me, I was like, okay, well, he doesn't always have the ability. He still knows right from wrong. And that's what the doctor told me. The doctor said, hey, you know, pay attention. Cause sometimes he's just being a dick, you know, so someone who's bipolar can still be a prick, you know, they can still be an asshole to you, but they tend to have similar traits where they hurt a lot of the people that are the closest to them. Mm-hmm. Because they're really struggling. They're having a hard time, but yeah, seeing it kind of, firsthand, I do believe my brother, was born with it, but I also think it was something that got like activated later on. And I don't know a lot about bipolar disorder, so I'm not sure if like relationships can trigger it or anything like that, but he got involved in a relationship when he was very young, and I think that was part of it. He was like 16, you know, and he was with this girl from like 16 to like 20 or so, and I just think that wasn't I just didn't think that was really healthy. It seemed like that's kind of where everything started to kind of show its colors, and that's where everything kind of manifested.
Yeah, and it's difficult because the guys that you say, like, there's the box is being checked and there's no real difference. I think the one thing that what I would say is that for me at least, I'm able to control my emotions very well. At the end of the day, I'm kind of even keel throughout the entire spectrum, you know what I mean? So, and I think that has to do with my athletic background, maybe where I was brought up. You know, I didn't come from the you know, I didn't come with a silver spoon in my mouth. I obviously had some humble beginnings. And then going into competitive sports and then into fighting, I needed to make sure that I was calm and controlled under chaos. And that's one thing that I always take to me. My wife always asks me, why do you never get excited? Now, I'm excited. I just don't show it like many people because I'm trying to stay even, you know?
Yeah, it sounds a little bit like you're like myself. So I think I have matched my outward personality with I match it up against what's going on in my mind, because you're probably a fucking crazy madman like I am inside your mind. Mm-hmm. You know, like I'm not angry. It's actually really rare for me to get mad. I can sometimes get frustrated, I guess. Mm-hmm. But for the most part, like, I'm always trying to think of new ideas. I'm always trying to think of different ways of getting better. For sure. And so my mind's racing like that. Mm-hmm. But on the other end, I think my personality has been very even keel, and like, my staff has never seen me mad. Mm-hmm. They've seen me like, they've seen me like laugh and have like a good time, but they haven't even really seen me like be super pumped and like really laugh my ass off. Like, they've seen me like once or twice, and they like really enjoyed it, 'cause they're like, wow, I've never seen you laugh like that before. I'm like, oh yeah, every once in a while, you know. But like, I don't try to stuff those feelings away either. Mm-hmm. But I feel really good, you know, being kind of even keel, and it probably has a lot to do with the mind racing all the time, trying to think of new products and new concepts and things like that.
Yeah, I'm the same 100%. Like, if I don't have 8-9 things going on, I just feel like I'm not doing anything. So, you know what I mean? I have like 8 or 9 sources of income and doing plenty of different things, and then adding on to a podcast, I thought that this would be good too as well. yeah, let's talk about that a little bit, because, you know, with the products that you have, I did want to talk about this, because I'm a business owner myself. What made you develop the Slingshot, and what like catapulted your business like that now? Because everybody knows primarily what Slingshot is and what they do and what helps. How did you come about like getting that going?
You know, it all just came from like an interest. You know, I was just really, really interested in lifting. Mm-hmm. I loved it, and I'm a little bit maybe like Rain Man when it comes to like powerlifting equipment and powerlifting gear. And I used to mess around with different bench shirts and squat suits and knee wraps and wrist wraps and things like that. And I would sit there and kind of think about like, oh, I wonder if I wrap my knees like this, what it would do. Or I used to wonder a ton about different training protocols and training programs. Like, you know, Louis Simmons talks a lot about like dynamic effort work and speed work, but I'm like, well, what if you train really slow? Like, what are the effects of that? You know, what if you try to intentionally, you know, have a 6 or 8 second, you know, lowering phase of a squat? And what if you tried, you know, bands and chains and weight releasers? And like, I was always very fascinated by that. And a lot of that was kicked off by Louis Simmons, a lot of his principles, the conjugate system, changing up exercises fits my personality type really, really well. 'Cause I like you said, it's like you want to have multiple things going on at the same time. And the conjugate system is perfect for that. Like, it's like somebody who has workout ADHD. It's like your ADHD workout wet dream, right? It's an amazing protocol. But yeah, training has just always been on the front of my mind, and how to get better at it, how to solve problems for it. So there was a period of time where I was powerlifting, and I was gaining quite a bit of strength. I think at the time I was squatting around 800-900 pounds, somewhere in that range.
Yeah.
And I was starting to put up some numbers in the bench as well. And I remember like getting around older people, and they would say, oh man, I remember when I used to do that. And they'd say like, I remember when I used to bench, you know, 400 pounds or 300 pounds or whatever it might be. And I was always like, I don't understand, because I was like early 30s probably or so. I was like, I don't understand why they say they used to do it. Like, well, how come they don't still do it? Like, lifting is so much fun. Like, I'm going to lift my whole life, you know? But then as I got a little older and started running into some injuries and just started to push the envelope with bigger benches all the time and stuff like that, you know, I tore my pec. And once I tore my pec, then when I started to gain strength again, it was different. You know, I just wasn't the same. You know, my explosiveness wasn't the same. Yeah. And then I started kind of thinking, oh shit, now I'm kind of like those old dudes at the gym who used to say, oh, I used to do this, I used to do that. And I was still able to gain back a lot of strength because I didn't have like a full like rupture or anything like that. But then, you know, it happened again, and my elbow was hurting and a bunch of things were going on. So I just, one day I was with my dad, and I was telling him about this idea. I had the idea for a while before I really acted on it. And I'm explaining to my dad. My dad's not understanding what I'm talking about. And so I grab some wrist wraps from the trunk of my car. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, well, I think this thing would work like this. You know, you'd like wrap, you know, one arm this way and one arm that way. And then you'd Velcro it in the middle. Mm-hmm. And I was like, hold on to the middle. I'm going to, you know, pull this thing back and see what happens. So I pulled it back and the Velcro snaps and it hits him in the He's like, well, I don't think that's a very good product. I was like, actually, no, that's it. Like that's the way it's supposed to feel. Cause it like, it it's would like, spot your elbows the way that somebody would assist your elbows on like incline dumbbell bench press or something like that. And so I was trying to think of a bunch of different ways to make that happen. I bought a really tight Under Armour shirt at the time. And, you know, before you put your shirt on all the way, if you put it up over both arms before you put it up over your head, it is across your chest. And so I tried to bench press with an Under Armour shirt that way. That was like, you know, like a kid's medium or something, you know, it was like really tiny. But it didn't work. It kind of worked. Like, I think it gave me like a little bit of extra strength, but it hurt. And it was just like weird. And just, so I was like, I don't know if that's like the right design, but I think I'm on something. I think if I could make it out of that wrist wrap material, I think that would be, you know, that would be a good way to go. So I was trying to figure it out for weeks on end, and I couldn't really come up with anything. And then I was talking to my wife, and I said, I think I got it now. I think all I need to do is take basically two knee wraps and sew them together. I think if they were sewed together, then they could, you know, have a hole, you know, for your arms and stuff like that. And so I was like, do you know how to sew like that? She's like, no, I don't have any idea how to sew something like that. She's like, but my friend at swimming, she makes swimsuits for the swim team. Okay. Like, I bet you she would be able to, you know, do something like that. She's got a pretty good machine and stuff like that. And and so I met with her at a Starbucks, and there was a Starbucks that was right next to a Fitness 19 in Woodland, California. And I met her, we went over the designs, and then I met her again the following week, and she came back with which is now like a slingshot. And I said, hey, stay right here for a second. I said, I'm gonna go run into that gym. I went to that gym. I just have my flip flops on, and I pretend like I own the place. That's the way to always get into a gym for free.
Yeah.
And I just kind of like, you know, go flying through there. I lay down on the bench and I bench 135 for a couple reps. I'm like, oh my God, that felt amazing. So then I went to 225 and I do 225 for like 10 reps and the weights are just bouncing off my chest. I'm like, holy shit, you know, this is it. And I got up off the bench and I just was covered in goosebumps head to toe. I was like, this is it. This is like my lottery ticket. Now I need to figure out like what to do with this damn thing. So
it's crazy.
Went back to that woman and I said, hey, I need a couple different sizes of these, because I need to test them in my gym and make sure that people aren't going to die when they try to use it. and from there, it was like, you know, some of the ways that some of these things came to be are, they're just so simple. And so this might be a good lesson for a lot of people listening, is like, it doesn't have to be complicated for it to be effective. And so I, you know, this is a very like, an American story, I think, because like I'm sitting inside of a Starbucks, you know, using their Wi-Fi on an iPad. And I type in, you know, the Google search. I mean, everyone has access to all these things. Everyone has an iPhone, right? Everyone has Google, you know, so I'm sitting inside. Everyone has a Starbucks in their neighborhood. I'm sitting at a Starbucks and I Google knee wrap manufacturers and I look it up. I look into it. I find a source. I get some slingshots made. Those didn't work out very good. Like they were red, which is, I wanted them to be red so that people would see them from across the gym. And it'd be very obvious that you were like wearing like a device if it was black. Powerlifters are fat and they all wear black. So I knew that if it was black, it would be kind of camouflaged by that. So anyway, the first batch of slingshots that I made turned people red, because when you would sweat into them, the dye would come off, and they just weren't designed well. They weren't strong enough and stuff. So I had to go back to the drawing board one extra time. I found another manufacturer and I was off the races. So there was nothing like, you know, I think people, they make everything like so dramatic all the time that everything's going to be so freaking like difficult. And those times were difficult for me just because I was broke. I just didn't have money. I had shitty cars and they would break down all the time. And It wasn't a very convenient way of living for me at that time. But when I look back at it and think about the progression of like just sitting at a Starbucks, Googling it, having it like be messed up one time, like which was super frustrating at the time because I spent $800 that I didn't have. But in retrospect, and then listening to other business owners, like $800, and to lose $800 in the business world, you know, it's not much of a sacrifice. And then it wasn't really a loss; it was a learning lesson. It was an opportunity to learn, you know, more on how I can make the product better. But yeah, man, just this simple thing of you know, following my interests. Always highly interested. My dad is kind of given me some good perspective on this. He's like, you know, while other people are maybe have been thinking about, you know, what they're going to do at work that day or what they're going to do on the weekend, you know, they go out for some drinks and stuff. He's like, you just consistently have thought about the same thing forever. And I was like, yeah. And it's, but it's not forced though. You know, that's the key is like with yourself, with fighting and with the way you train for fighting, it's like, there's, I mean, how many moments in the day, like how, like I bet you there's not hours that go by where you're not thinking about a new technique or a new training method or like it's almost like you're crazy, right? It's almost like you're possessed by it, right?
Yeah, you're definitely obsessed is a great word that I love to use. You know, if you're not obsessed, then you're not really ready to make it to the next level of the elites. You know, and that's pretty much, I mean, where you were, you know, with powerlifting. You had a knee injury and what else, other crazy injuries that, you know, you accumulated over the years, but that's because you were obsessed of getting stronger, you know. Now, super training, did you have the gym before you did Slingshot, or was that kind of the same, like at the same time?
Yeah, the gym was first. And then what came shortly after that was Power Magazine. We had a magazine for a good run there, about 5 years of putting that together. And then it wasn't too long after that we came up with the concept of the Slingshot.
Yeah. Now, again, like I said, when you're talking about Mark Bell, he is, again, like I always will say, and even though you may be watching him on Instagram and maybe hating on him right now, hopefully my viewers and my listeners aren't doing that shit. Like I said, he gives to the community. Now, super training itself, the gym is free, correct?
Yeah, super training is free, and that's something I always wanted. You know, from the time I was a kid, I don't know about you, like, but getting into gyms back in the day, like, it, you know, again, like my dad did well. Like we had money, but like I didn't have any money. And as I got older, you know, my dad's very supportive. My parents are very supportive, but they're also like, they want you to get on with your life and get moving in the right direction for yourself. So when I was like 19 and 20 and like trying to get into these gyms was like hard for me to figure out because I just didn't have any dough. So I was always trying to like sneak in or get in on somebody else's pass or use a free pass that like was expired or some shit, you know, stuff like that, like all the time, or sneaking through the back door or whatever.
Yeah.
So I was always like, man, if I ever have an opportunity, you know, I'm going to have a facility that's free. And so as soon as I had the chance to do that, the super training hasn't always been free. The first, about 2 years or so of its existence, it was $125 a month. And, you know, people were really paying, they were paying to be part of a team, you know, rather than like, it wasn't like just like, it wasn't like personal training sessions. It was like, no, you're paying to be part of this team and you're never going to have a bad workout.
Yeah.
After a while, I started getting busy with a lot of other things and Slingshot started to take off. And I was like, I don't have time. You know, I don't really have time to really, you know, invest in that new guy over there who's squatting and his knees are caving in, you know, like I'll get to him at some point, but I don't want him paying for this without me being able to really give him the attention that he needs and without the other guys in the gym being able to give him the attention that he needs. So that's why we scratched it.
Yeah. I mean, you've coached youth athletes before. I know in Bigger, Stronger, Faster. If you guys haven't checked out Bigger, Stronger, Faster, make sure you go ahead and check that out. Documentary is crazy. It was funny because we actually watched it in my undergrad. My exercise science undergrad. So yeah, we watched it there. I watched it before, but I was like, watch this. I was telling everybody, check this out. But yeah, you can see like you've coached before and your rise and even going to Westside and working with Louis. That probably helped you out too, because I know Louis doesn't have the guys pay for anything really. He pays for pretty much everything. And it's something that for me, like, yeah, a lot of my fighters, you know, they come in, they don't have to pay the gym at all, you know, and most of it is through American Top Team for the most part, you know, and I'm working with my high school football team now, so I want to give back to the community, and that's something that I see you and Louis do, and that's, you know, I want to give back to the people that, or at least molded me the way I am now, you know.
I absolutely love coaching people, and I, you probably find this happen often for yourself as well, where you go to explain something to somebody and you're like, holy shit, like, what did I just say? Like, that was actually like, you know, it's like you want to give yourself a pat on the back, because you're like, well, that actually sounded pretty fairly intelligent, you know, coming from me. But it's just, it's what we love to do, you know. Mm-hmm. it's where our interest really is, and coaching is fascinating, you know, really learning how to really how to get the most out of somebody. Like, sometimes you got to play like kind of mind games on somebody, and sometimes, I mean, it's a real trip to try to figure out, you know, how to get the most out of people. I don't know if you're watching The Last Dance on ESPN.
I need to. I haven't watched it yet. I need to.
Yeah, so they had four episodes so far, and mm-hmm. they had an episode on Phil Jackson. They had an episode on Dennis Rodman. Mm-hmm. But with Dennis Rodman, you know, so Scottie Pippen comes back to the Bulls. He was injured for a while. Mm-hmm. And then Rodman feels like the third wheel. And Rodman, like, he's, you know, he's just kind of immature. And so he gets kind of sad. And he tells Phil Jackson, he's like, man, I need to get out of here. And Phil Jackson's like, kind of like, huh? And Rodman told Jordan, he's like, I'm going to go to Vegas for a few days. Yeah. And Jordan's like, you can't go to Vegas? Like, what are you talking about? So Rodman ends up talking to Phil Jackson, and Phil Jackson's like, hey, you know, if you feel like going to Vegas, go to Vegas, you know, but don't be gone for any longer than like 48 hours. So he's gone for a couple extra days, you know, more than the 48 hours. But Phil Jackson, you know, the Zen master, he knew how to coach people. He knew, look, man, it's not going to do us any good if Rodman's around here and he doesn't want to be here.
Yeah.
Like, just, you know, go and like miss a couple practices. Go for it. Like, just you're going to be fine. And you probably have a lot of athletes like that are just different, man. Yeah. They're just, you can't put your finger on it, but especially the great ones. A lot of times mm-hmm. the greatest people, they might have a killer work ethic and they might have a lot of these things, but they almost always have a couple things that are so wildly different from everybody else, where you're like, that cat is just, you hear this a lot about like someone like Michael Phelps, you know?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know, you hear it a lot about Bones Jones, you know, you hear a lot about these real talented guys. They just operate a little differently than everybody else.
Yeah. I could honestly say that about Joanna Janjacek. She definitely is operating on a different wavelength with a lot of girls, not just females, but people in general, and you could see the reason why. And as a coach, you have to develop an ability to communicate with all different types of individuals. And learning personality traits is going to be a key for any coach, because you can learn everything from a science, you know, science perspective, but you got to get on the floor and actually, you know, create communication and have that ability to talk with a person, and then also relay over information that they can understand.
You know? You might have an athlete that just really wants to be really active. Mm-hmm. You know, and you might say, hey, you know, I told you, we got to calm it down. But if you're doing that all the time to them, and it's now, if you're doing it all the time to them and it's really benefiting them, and they can, mm-hmm. they see it and they know that that's in their best interest, and maybe that's kind of a different story. But if you're just placating to that all the time, you know, maybe that's not good. Or maybe saying, you know what, like, I know you like the extra activity, so we're going to let you do A, B, and C. But you let mm-hmm. them do stuff that is still the extra work, so they feel like they're active, but it's not harming them in any way. You know, it's tough, man. It's like a real not an easy thing to balance.
Yeah, you got to give them what they want, but also make sure they're getting what they need. So that goes with programming. That goes with understanding. That's why, like, I always sit the guys down or girls down within the first time I meet them and have like a 2-hour conversation with them. What are you drinking right there? Is that a cold brew, or is that just cold pressed? The hot
coffee right there. Yep.
Listen, I can't start my day without that. So, yeah. Yeah, so I got the guys training right now, and it's lightning out, and I was gonna have them do sled drags. So my guy's like, he put a picture just on the window. It's lightning. Do you want to go? I don't know. Let's see what happens. Nah, don't let him go out there, please. So I wanted to talk about this because let's transition a little bit. You were, and I quote you, you were a fat power lifter at one point. Now you're jacked to the gills, by the way. And then on top of that, you have a better gas tank. What do you contribute to that right now? Like, I know what you're doing, and I know we do. Are you doing the nasal breathing still?
Yeah, I am. Yep.
Yeah.
I'm still working on it. Yep.
All right. Good. Good. And are you using a work in progress. You're using a CPAP machine, are you? You don't like that thing, right?
Yeah. You know what? I've never been able to adapt to one. Yeah.
Yeah. I didn't like it either. Like even just kind of trying it out just to see. And then I'm using the mouth strips now.
Yep, so I use mouth tape. Yep.
Yeah, mouth tape. Yeah. So okay, I know you work with Hani Rambod, right? For the bodybuilding show.
Yep.
How was that different from getting ready for a powerlifting meet? Because I know it's totally different. You know, and you did well too, by the way. But
yeah, you know, I would say before I explain how it's different, like one thing that's amazing, it's just. It just always lights up my brain. You know, when I see people that can operate at a really high level, like my brain just explodes. Like I was just watching some of Jerry Seinfeld last night. I was watching one of his stand-up things. He's got one of them up on Netflix, and he's just so brilliant. He's just so like high end of what he does. Like who is higher as a stand-up comedian than Jerry Seinfeld? Like there's not a lot of people. Like you can maybe compare him to some other people, right? But he's one of the best in the world. And when you get around people that are the best in the world, like I've worked out with guys like Jay Cutler and guys like Phil Heath and having Hani Rambod train me, the guy that has trained, multiple Mr. Olympia champions, it blows your mind of how talented these guys are and how good they are. When it comes to like there's so much nuance when it comes to like training that it's hard to even to use the English language to describe it the right way. But you know, Hani had me do some stuff in a workout where, you know, it's very early on in the workout. I mean, we're 10 minutes in and I'm like, wow, I am completely screwed. Like I'm not gonna have any. Okay, we were halfway through the first series of exercises. I'm like, I am really screwed, you know? And he just absolutely killed me, absolutely crushed me. And I love seeing that level. I love like, all right, here we go. Mm-hmm. Like it was like that with Branch Warren, who was a runner up in the Mr. Olympia as well. Mm-hmm. Branch should have probably never, you know, placed as high as he did. He was short, he was stocky. He didn't really have the look of a lot of the other athletes, but he didn't care. Mm-hmm. He just trained like an animal, and when I had an opportunity to train with him, it was like go everything. You know, I was like, okay, how many sets do you do? How many reps do you do? And he's not answering any of it. He just keeps going.
Yeah.
He did a lot of reps. He did a lot of sets, and he did a lot of weight, and he didn't have much rest, and none of it made any sense. But he didn't care.
Yeah.
Like just fucking, he just went. You know, and I love seeing that level. The biggest difference between the training for bodybuilding versus the training for powerlifting is one, you know, the training when it comes to actual training, obviously you want less of a break in your training. So less rest interval. Mm-hmm. You actually kind of are favoring. And actually, I think this is a good practice for everybody to do occasionally. You want incomplete rest. You don't really want complete rest because you want incomplete rest. So that way you get a pump. You know, if you could think it sounds so bro-y, you know.
Yeah.
it sounds so bro-ish, but I mean, literally, if you get a pump during a workout and you continue to get that pump and you ride that pump out for 30, 40 minutes or so, and you do it every week for a period of time, like you're gonna get jacked. You're gonna gain muscle size. Now you have to complement that with proper nutrition and proper sleep and a lot of things like that. And as you know, in bodybuilding, there's tons of drugs in there as well. Mm-hmm. But the biggest difference was mainly the rest intervals. That was kind of the only thing that changed. A lot of the exercises were very similar for me. Mm-hmm. The main exercise was still like, I'd still like bench, squat, and deadlift though, because I'm a power lifter and that's, mm-hmm. that's what I know to do. And so that's, those are like your money makers. You know, I think it doesn't matter what you're doing. It doesn't matter if it's MMA or if you're, yeah. A runner, or if you, I mean, bench, squat, deadlift, like they're fantastic. And mm-hmm. you might have different versions of them, and maybe you kick out a deadlift for a while and you work on your squat and vice versa, because mm-hmm. you don't need to be really gifted at all three to be a good athlete or anything, but they're great fundamental things to work on. The main difference though was just in the nutrition. Yeah. You know, as a power lifter, especially like when I got up to 330 and got really big and fat, when I did that, that was kind of like almost like an experiment to see, okay, you know, how big can I get, and then how beneficial is this? Mm-hmm. And it didn't work well. I was my strongest and my best at about 290 pounds. Mm-hmm. So I went about 40 pounds beyond probably where I needed to, mm-hmm. but had I never done that, I would have never knew that. So it was a good thing for me to dive into and to check into. But I think something that people probably don't know is that my nutrition was always pretty good, even when I was fat. So like when I was fat, it was still all about protein. It was still a meat-based diet. Mm-hmm. There was still a lot of steak, a lot of ground beef, a lot of eggs, you know. And then this is where things would get different, is there would be a lot of carbohydrates in there as well. Mm-hmm. In addition to like cheese and like just kind of high energy foods, mm-hmm. that have a lot of calories. So that's kind of the main difference was just really the nutrition. When it comes to bodybuilding diets are almost always the same. There's not really anything too fancy about them. Mm-hmm. They're usually low to moderate amounts of fat. Yeah. Your protein is going to be about your body weight in grams of protein. And for me, it was like 1.5 times my body weight or whatever. And then when it came to carbohydrates, because I came from such a low carb background, Hani was like, we got 8 weeks, so we're not really messing with that. So mm-hmm. you're going to be low fat and low carbs. Like, he's like, get ready for the ride, you know? And so that's pretty much what it was. On a high carb day for me, I would have maybe 200, maybe 225, which, as you know, it's like, that's just not really that much for a guy my size.
No. I did a bodybuilding show right after I retired from MMA, because I just wanted to compete in something different and change my body up. And I literally had to go 4 days egg whites and whitefish up into the competition. And then even then I had to make the weight class. So I actually did the wrong thing and did what I always know, is cut weight in the sauna, and ended up flattening out in right before pre-judging. So, but I ended up taking first place, so it worked out well enough.
What do you think about bodybuilding for let's say you're a young guy, young male or female, and you're getting into like some jiu-jitsu and some mm-hmm. MMA. Do you think some general bodybuilding practices are good, or do you think they should be really working on a lot of explosive stuff with like med balls and things of that nature?
Well, it depends on their level of preparedness. Like Louis always says, you know, you want to put the muscle on in the right places. So a lot of posterior chain work is usually what I emphasize. It's more upper back, hamstrings, glutes. Because a lot of the guys that are going to do jiu-jitsu, right, they're going to be on their back primarily to learn certain positions and movements. And they don't get a whole lot of work in extension. So they work primarily in flexion. We need to work on the antagonistic to help balance the body out. And then if they're just frail, then you just want to build up some armor, you know. And in general, if they're a young kid, the basics always work. Like you said, squat, bench, and deadlift. And then on top of that, you could throw in some cleans if they're efficient in it. They have the proper joint prerequisites. But for me, I like to see, because I'm going to get back into working with the youth athletes, even as young as 7 to 10 year olds. And a lot of that's going to be just sled dragging, you know, rope climbing, just back to the basics so that they can get a baseline of strength. But as far as building mass and building like solid muscle, you got to think of it as, okay, what muscle is going to be functional for the sport, you know, and from there it's usually going to be, you know, again, the posterior chain in general. So
yeah, and from a powerlifting perspective, you know, something for people to keep in mind, you know, gaining weight is like the fastest way to gain some strength, you know, and so that's the reason why I ballooned myself all the way up to that 330 pounds. And it's just like, if you're a younger person and you're like you said, frail, like you're fairly thin, you know, it's probably in your best interest to try to figure out, yeah, how do I get a little bit thicker? How do I gain a little bit of weight? And maybe you're in like a weight class, maybe you do wrestling or something like that. Mm-hmm. And so you might have to, you know, pay attention to some of that. But, you know, one of our guys at the gym, Josh Setledge, I think you had a chance to meet him. He's done a great job of, like, you know, he had a very thin frame. Mm-hmm. And I think he's got it down pretty good. Like, he's utilizing what you're saying is, like, you're going to utilize a good mixture. You know, you utilize a little bit of stuff from bodybuilding, a little bit of stuff from powerlifting, a little bit of stuff from something that you might see like an Olympic thrower do, you know, someone mm-hmm. that throws shot or disc, because you need some of the explosive components to it. And then it makes it fun, man. Like, yeah, going in the gym and doing some like box squats or something like that is kind of fun. And then doing some bodybuilding and looking at yourself in the mirror is kind of fun. Yeah. And then tossing around a med ball like a maniac or doing some sprints or something like that is fun.
Yeah, the main thing that I tell the fighters now, because a lot of them don't have fights coming up, and some do, but for the most part they don't. And I'm like, man, listen, the ones that are starting to come to me and do strength training, I said, for the most part, you know, the sport of MMA, combat sports in general, was 90% mental. As soon as the cage door closes or you step into the ring, if that's going to give you that psychological edge that you feel, because you know you're stronger now, you know you're a little bit bigger, you have a little bit more muscle mass, you have a little bit more joint integrity, it's going to help you in your game plan. It's going to help you in your performance because you have that confidence, and that's a major key. So I know for me, like, I've always trained no matter what. Like, even if I was getting ready for football or MMA, the training changed, and obviously my weight changed. I was 205 in high school, and then I had to fight at 155 in you know, as a pro fighter, you know. So it's like that changed. But I remember, like, always catering towards the stuff that was going to make me better for the sport, but nothing, like, as far as the compound lifts, they always stay the same, you know.
And like the stuff that I'm doing now, like, I'm getting more into like running. I'm doing a lot of stuff with like a weight vest and things mm-hmm. like that. My body is really just, to put it plainly, my body is just weird and different. You know, it's like, I've done some yoga and stuff like that. And the yoga instructor is trying to like show me certain things. And, you know, I try to be as patient with it as I can. I try to do whatever I can to do some of these movements. Mm-hmm. Even working with like someone like Steffi Cohen or something like that, she showed me some different things, and she's looking at me like I got two heads, like, what's wrong with you? And it's like, well, I powerlifted for 30 years, and I squatted 1,080 and benched 854 pounds. I was also a professional wrestler for 5 years. I did football for a long time. I did boxing for a long time. Like, my shit is just kind of different. You know, my tissues are just, they're just mangled. We have a poster in the gym. I don't know if you had a chance to see it. It's like right next to our bathroom, but they did like a muscle biopsy of me. The muscle biopsy that they did of me, I have like the muscle density of like a rhinoceros or whatever, you know. So I don't think a rhinoceros is going to be all that like mobile and flexible, you know. And so for me, a lot of it is like, I'm just trying, like, talk about GPP, like, man, I'm really stacking up those GPP chips, because my physical preparedness for like what I'm trying to do right now was so low that even just a little bit of jogging is going to be something that's going to later assist me in being able to run, going to assist me to be able to sprint. And so, like, I have to be kind of creative, but also keep things very simple. So, like, just like running a hill.
Yeah.
Like, running a hill is so productive for me because it's going to be giving me a lot of force through the hamstrings, but it's making me move so much slower that it's way safer for me. So if you're a bigger guy and you're going to go out and try to do some sprints, especially if you used anabolics, you're going to go out and do a sprint and probably like pull something in your hip or your hammy. And so, like, hitting like a beach, you know, running in the sand, running where there's like a displacement, because when you think about when you're running a hill, it's like each step is a little bit higher. Mm-hmm. So you're not driving all that impact, all that force down on the ground. If you're running on a flat surface, man, that's going to hurt that much worse. So for me, it's like I'm just trying to build up to, like, I'm building up into just being able to be a little bit more like normal. Because I think your average person, even your average person who doesn't train, you could probably get them outside and get them to do, they could probably sprint as fast as they wanted and not have any repercussions for it. But if I do that, I'm going to blow this fucking whole engine to pieces.
Yeah, it's funny because like a lot of the veteran MMA guys that I have to be very careful with them, you know, and people see it on videos like, why is he basically doing physical therapy movements? I'm like, well, that's what we have to do right now. Like, that's the only thing we could do right now, you know, to keep them safe. And the whole thing is just to get the stimulus no matter what. And if it's efficient and it'll be effective for them because of the fact that, you know, whatever, like you said, running on the sand or uphill, you know, you got 1,000 pounds of force every time you go to each step, you know, and that's a lot of weight. You add stiffness and dysfunction and bilateral deficits in there. Well, now that's a recipe for disaster. So you just got to find a way. And that's what you've done, is just making sure you're optimizing what you have and then increasing it over time. And that's just regular progressions, you know.
So yeah, I'm pretty crappy when it comes to like, you know, some single leg stuff. So just the other day, I was like, wow, I really need to fix that, because I'm trying to run, and running, you're on a single leg every time. So I'm just like, yeah, you know what? I bet you if I fix that, that'll probably have a huge impact on my running.
Yeah, I was going to ask you that. Like, what's the training like right now? I know you're doing a lot of unilateral stuff. You're doing a lot of conditioning, a lot of circuits.
It's just a lot of fun, man. I don't have like a program, and it's great. I just go and do like what feels fun. So like a lot of times when I go on a walk, a lot of times I have like a 40-pound weight vest. Mm-hmm. And sometimes I'm like, you know, throughout this walk, I might walk for like 90 minutes. Throughout this 90-minute walk, I might sprint, you know, anywhere between like 4 times and maybe on a high end, maybe 10 times. Yeah. And they're not full-on sprints, because like I said, I just don't feel that I'm really ready for that yet. I have sprinted in the past and ended up, you know, tweaking stuff. So, And sometimes I'm like, all right, well, I know that this hill takes about 2 minutes to get to the top. I'm just going to jog the whole thing. I'm just going to run the whole thing. And so it just kind of it just depends. And like, I'm setting up all these like little it's like a West Side Barbell version of running, because I'm setting up all these like mini PRs, like mini maxes. I have all these different destinations where I'm like, okay, last time, and I have them saved in my phone. And I'm like, okay, last time when I ran that took me 2 minutes. I want to see if I can do it, you know, in less time. And I'm so bad at running that my increases are like radical, you know, like I'll beat a time by like 30 seconds, you know, because I was so shitty in the beginning. Now I'm starting to get a little bit better. I think like one of the runs I've been messing with is, it's got to be a little over a mile, and it's just the whole thing is just uphill, you know. And you know, if you like, even just a couple weeks ago, really, for me to, you know, if you said, hey, you know, you got to run that hill, I'd be like, I'm gonna die. I'm not gonna be able to make it. But I've been able to push through, and it's been feeling really good. But something I've noticed, and this might help people, especially in this quarantine, is don't think of your workouts as being like, don't think of them as having to be anything particular. Like, there's no real rule. Like, if you're following programming, that's kind of different, but there's no real rule anywhere that says you have to do 3 sets of something. There's no real rule that says you have to do things for 4 rounds. There's no, like, I know we like to have some synergy in our workouts. So we might do the other day I did some like, kind of like kettlebell swings, some overhead presses, and some like suitcase deadlifts. And I went through that like 3 times, but you know, I have a lot of like workout ADHD. So I was like, on the second round of that, I was like, oh, I'm going to throw in pushups. And on the third round of it, I threw in some lunges, you know? And so like, I just was throwing in more stuff, but there's no real reason to think like, if I throw in X, Y, or Z, or if I take out X, Y, or Z, that it's going to have this like massive negative impact, and then it's not a good workout. Like, take your workouts and simplify them. You don't need any special equipment. You don't need any special clothing. Keep them simple. There's no magical rep number. You know, if you do something for 3 reps and you feel like that's good enough, and switch to the other arm or switch to the other leg, just have at it. Like, I think maybe sometimes people don't have enough training experience to maybe know how to do that, because they don't know all the different exercises. But if you've been doing this stuff for a long time, like, literally just make it so it's fun. And then when it hurts or it gets challenging, if you feel like it's a good day to push that, that's when you want to kind of lean into that. And when you start to kind of feel a little bit of that, I have people that struggle so much with like motivation. And I'm like, you shouldn't be struggling with motivation. I think people suffer and they struggle with motivation because they work too damn hard the day before a lot of times. Like, you put so much into it on one day, and then you don't get adequate sleep because you're messing around on your phone or watching TV or whatever it is. And then it's hard. Of course you don't have motivation. If I'm fatigued, if I'm super tired, if we stayed up until 1 o'clock, I'm not going to be that motivated to work out at 6 a.m. So make stuff, keep stuff simple. Keep it the low-hanging fruit, that some stuff that you can do that can be repeatable, stuff that you can do day in and day out.
Yeah. And that's something, because, you know, when I always say, it's like, the more you know the rules, the more you can break them, you know? So at that point, it's like just kind of feeling out process. And that's, honestly, that's how Conjugate is made in a way. It's like kind of feeling out every day. Like, okay, this is what we feel like we're going to do today. Let's do it. And let's knock it out the park. Let's go 100% as we can, you know, especially on max efforts. But like with the body armor program that I have, the body weight program, it's to max failure, like literally max failure. So your intent is important. And that's if you're trying to build muscle, that's very important, because now the tempo becomes an issue. That, you know, building up that metabolic stress and muscle damage in general. And I think that was one thing that like made you so successful in it. It was because of the fact that you're able to push through pain, you know, and a lot of people can't do that. So for some people, they need that set and rep range. They're like, okay, I need to do this. And a lot of my guys really don't know how to lift. So with that, I have to be like, I have to kind of be that guide in a way. But if you know it, go after it. You know what I mean?
Yeah, having an intent is really, really critical, especially when you have a goal. Because you want things to align with the goal. Like, what are we trying to do? But for me, you know, I'm retired from powerlifting, so my goal is just to be able to like run a little bit better. So like, I don't have a real specific goal ironed out. I'm sure at some point I probably will, because that's usually what happens. Is as I get more interested in something and as I dive in deeper. And then the more specific the goal is, the more specific the recipe needs to be to get me there quicker. For now, it really doesn't matter, because I don't have much experience with running. So it's like, hey, I'm just going to like run periodically, like kind of like when I feel like it. I am doing some running pretty much every single day. Yeah. But the intent of your day is massively important, especially when you have a goal around it. And I've been talking about this for years. You know, I did for basically 10 years straight, you know, every single time I walked into the gym, I had an intent, and the intent was planned out ahead of time. I wasn't too specific with like weights. I was not much of a percentage guy or anything like that, but I would have it in my head. Okay, I'm doing that squat tomorrow with 5 chains per side. I should be able to do about this amount of weight with the safety squat bar. And then I knew, you know, I started to get an idea. But like, having an intent and having kind of a main focus was always super important. And then I always back that up too with, I was a big proponent and big believer, and this is something that can help a lot of coaches, I think, is to have what I used to call a secondary barbell movement. And a secondary barbell movement is just taking the first movement that you had and slightly changing it. So a real easy example is you were bench pressing, and now you're going to do, you know, 4 sets of 4 of some close grip bench presses off a board or something like that. You were doing some sumo pulls. Well, now you're going to do, you know, 3 sets of 3 of some conventional pulls. But that secondary barbell movement was something that you talked about pushing through pain. That was like, all right, you already went heavy. You nearly passed out when you did that heavy ass squat. and now we got to do three sets of three or three sets of six or something of something that you really probably just don't want to do. It could be maybe it's a closed stance, heels elevated, squat to the floor. You know, you try to get your ass all the way down on the ground or something like that. Mm-hmm. And those secondary barbell movements were I always think, like the kind of advantage makers, because those were the things where I could really think about. I could think about the movement. I could think about the exercise because it wasn't a max. Mm-hmm. And it was like I could think about, like, you know, what do I want to do? What do I want to become? How good do I really want to be? Like, this is going to show you, like, if I don't feel like doing this exercise or if I half-ass it, then I'm not as interested as I thought I was in being the best.
Yeah, that's interesting. I usually do that too as well, believe it or not. I'll go either threes or fives on like a secondary movement, whether it be a supplemental or something like that.
That's great. It makes it simple and it makes it easy to communicate to the client, because you're like, you're just going to take that first movement. And you're just going to move your hands in a little closer. Like they don't, you don't have to re-explain everything to them, you know?
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. I want to get two questions out of the way. And I know, you know, I don't know if you're crunched for time, but I want to make sure that I'm not taking too much of your time. Two questions. And I ask all the guests this. The first one is going to be, I would like to know what Mark does on a daily basis. What's your morning routine? Because again, if I'm studying pretty much successful people on a daily basis, I want to know what they start their day with. So Mark, go ahead and tell the people, what's your daily routine?
Yeah, you know, I don't start any days blindly. So I try to review the day before, sometime like a couple days in advance, make sure that I know like what's going to happen with a particular day. But other than that, I don't really have a lot of rules. Like I'm not real like ritualistic. Like I always know that my exercise is going to happen. So mm-hmm. I know this is probably a little different than what most people talk about, because most people like to work out the same time every day, wake up the same time every day. I probably do wake up and go to bed similar times most days, but I'm not really like, my day isn't like really planned out. Mm-hmm. But, you know, like an example would be like today, you know, I had a podcast previously to this. And I just like last night or while I was on my run yesterday, I was just kind of like, I was like, oh man, I wonder what I need to do tomorrow. And when I was in between walking and running, while I was walking, I was like, oh, let me check my calendar. Oh yeah, I got the thing with Phil tomorrow. I have that podcast a little earlier in the morning. And then I just start to kind of think about, okay, like around what time are you going to lift? Around what time are you going to eat? Mm-hmm. And so then I start to think about it that way. But something I've learned and something that's been very useful is I never really start a day until it's already finished. So what I mean by that is like I already, before the day ever starts, I've already played it out. Okay. I already have a good idea and good concept of like what I'm going to be doing.
Gotcha.
And if you're somebody that has struggled with like weight loss, you're somebody that struggled with your diet, you should have a good idea of like when you're going to eat, where you're going to eat, where's that food going to come from. Mm-hmm. And you really, when it comes to that kind of thing, and the more goals that you have, the more planning, the more prepared you're going to have to be for stuff. Because again, a lot of stuff will come down to interest and motivation. And if you're not interested and you're not motivated, it's probably because you didn't plan. And you're like, it's too hard. Like, I don't want to have to thaw out the chicken breast and then wait for the rice to cook. And, but if you were prepared, then you'd be like, oh, I'm just going to grab the chicken and rice out of the fridge. All I got to do is pop it in the microwave and it's a done deal. So I just always try to be as prepared for each day as possible, but I don't really have a lot of routine. I do write shit down a lot. Mm-hmm. I got my handy dandy notebook right here. And I kind of see if there's any examples of it right here. I kind of write sometimes like a maniac. I write like all over the place. And that's been kind of helpful to me because like, yeah, if you, I don't know, if you write notes too structured, mm-hmm. I think that you might be unlikely to ever go back and really look at them. And when you go back and look at them, you might not know what you're looking at. Mm-hmm. And so, like, I might write my notes like this, which is kind of normal. I just have crap handwriting. Mm-hmm. Then, like, things that are more important are things that I think are you know, need to be like highlighted, I might write them like that and take up a whole page and have them be like crazy and big. And like, sometimes I'll write sideways and sometimes I'll circle it. And, but, a really massive thing that I do that I think that might be a little different from people is I actually go back and read my notes. Like, so I write stuff down often, and a lot of times these things that I'm writing down are, things that I hear from, maybe like a YouTube video or something like that. Like I will listen to stuff occasionally and not write anything down, but I've learned that it's harder for me to really learn and retain the information the way that I need to. So if I'm going to look up something on like Stoic philosophy or something like that, then I'm going to sit down like a student. I'm going to have headphones on. I'm going to try to be uninterrupted the best I can. And I'm going to sit down and I'm going to hone in and I'm going to focus in on that. But again, like I don't have like a, I'm not a person who's like, I'm doing that from 3 to 4.
Yeah.
I don't put those, stresses on myself. I just do it when I feel like doing it.
Yeah. Some people like a great analogy, I guess you would say, is some people are cooks and some people are chefs. I think you've touched on this before, right? And like at the end of the day, like I'm similar to that. Like I don't like to be super structured, but I also like to be organized to a degree of like, okay, I know what I'm doing when I'm supposed to do it. But that makes sense. So, all right. So now the second question is going to be, and you can probably answer this better than almost any of my guests right now. What is your definition of a strong person? Now, could be physical, could be mental. What's your definition?
A strong person is able to just handle a lot. You mm-hmm. know, they're able to handle. They're able to handle more than most, you know, and it's in all aspects, you know. When it comes to strength, obviously, like it would be the person that can handle the most weight, right? But when it comes to life, it's the same thing, like who can handle the most amount of resistance. And that's really what it's about. And I get super frustrated because I'll hear people say stuff that and they don't even know that they're saying stuff that's just weak. But like I might text somebody and say, hey man, you got time to, you know, maybe be on my podcast next week or the week after or whatever. I will get this text that's super long, right? and it's just like, it's like, yes I can or no I can't, or hey, you know what, like June or July would actually probably work better for me because maybe like you're fucking busy, maybe you have a book deadline or something. Like I got friends that are writing books and different things, and I'm respectful of all that, but at the same time, a lot of times I get this big long text and they're like, my kids did this, and then they're like, man, I'm super swamped, like there's no way I could get to that next week. And I'm like, why do I need to know that? Why are you pushing your negative fucking bullshit on me? I don't need to know all that. I just need to know whether you can do it or not. And also, why are you overwhelmed? Like, you shouldn't be overwhelmed. A strong person is never overwhelmed. I like to kind of, even though I haven't practiced martial arts myself, I'm a huge Bruce Lee fan. And I like to, Bruce Lee is my symbol. He's my go-to. You know, if I ever feel like, okay, you got a lot of stuff lined up, all right, well, fucking Bruce Lee it, man. Like Bruce Lee, he would hit a person once, and you don't know if that person died or what happened, but that person would be gone, right? And then he would hit the next person, he'd hit the next person, the next person. He'd wipe out 4 or 5 people, you know? So I'm trying to think of my days as being like that. You know, I got 5 or 6 different things, and just as long as I have the technique, then I can get through it all very easily, just like Bruce Lee did. He had all the technique, he had all the right moves. Remember, he'd like headlock the dude, and then he'd kick him with his other foot, like in the head, and use one guy to like beat up the other guy, and like all that kind of craziness. But he was always like, you know, smooth and composed, and he says to be like water. So for me, my definition of strength is really just in somebody that can handle, you know, the weight of life, handle the resistance of life, and have it not seem, you know, like I'm sure you see this a lot with your fighters, where each person goes through a drill and it was pretty difficult for this person, pretty difficult for that person, and then one person blazes right through it and everybody's like, damn. Like, okay, shit, that's how we're playing this game. That's how it's done. Like, oh, crap.
Oh, they'll make it known, too. Like, oh, this fucking guy, of course, he's going to be good at it.
It's probably always the same guy, right, every time.
Always, always. Well, that was probably the best answer that we had so far, so thank you for that. All right, so I'm going to go ahead and let you get out of here. Plug anything that you want, you know, the podcast, obviously. Hopefully I'll come back on your podcast at some point. And, you know, we'll get to train a little bit, too, if I can get back out to California once all this craziness ends. So go ahead, the floor is yours.
I don't know if we'll be able to train because I'm going to turn into, like, a little skinny runner.
We can do something. Maybe we'll do some mobility work.
Yeah, we'll do a yoga class together.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, you can find me. I'm at Mark Smellybell on Instagram, Twitter, YouTube. And then, you know, check out MarkBellSlingshot.com if you want to check out, you know, a slingshot. We have elbow sleeves, knee sleeves, all that good stuff along with apparel. If you want to check out that website, that's where you'd go to pick up all your strength needs.
All right, man. Thanks again, Mark. I appreciate you coming on, man. You're a true legend.
Yeah, thank you.
All right. We'll talk soon, and we're out.